So I started collecting in October of 2008. My wife and I just were new parents. I had a 4-month-old, and we were driving past a laundromat in a town nearby where we live, and they had an old Miss Pac-Man machine sitting on the side of the sidewalk right next to the building. We drove past it and kind of just like caught my eye, and you know, like we'd all played arcade games growing up, and I kind of said to my wife, like, oh, I should ask them if, you know, they're just getting rid of that machine. That'd be kind of cool, because, you know, we had just bought a house as well, and I had a garage, so I could stick it somewhere, you know, just for the time being. I figured, man, I could probably sell it and make, you know, $100 or something. So anyways, my wife said, oh, well, you know, call my brother and, you know, go back and get it, because he had a truck. And so we went, picked it up. Guy said it wasn't working, you know, he just wanted to get rid of it. It was pretty beat up, but still salvageable, full of roaches, and took it home. You could hear the quarters jangling in the machine on the way home, and opened up the coin door, and, you know, we drilled it out. There's all these coins laying all over the floor, about $5 worth, so actually made a little bit of a profit. My brother-in-law and I, we had no clue what we were doing, what we were looking at. And I just tried to, you know, look at some wires and just kind of jiggled a few and got the machine going that night just by, you know, mere luck. And it just kind of ignited. I don't even know. You know, it just kind of seemed like such a cool idea for a hobby. You know, I play in a band, and you know, I think we're out with guitars and stuff like that, but this seemed like such a unique and kind of obscure hobby, and I was like, oh, well, you know, maybe I'll restore this thing. And 3 years later, I now have, I think, 16 arcade machines, and I have 3 pinball machines, so I might be off by a number. That's sad when you don't even know how many machines you have. My wife and I have a 2-bedroom, 1-bath bungalow. Basement's unfinished. House is almost 100 years old, and I don't have the money to finish it, so kind of figured, well, maybe I'll get another machine, and another machine. And I kept finding these amazing deals on Craigslist. You know, you'd find someone that had a broken old arcade machine for like $50 or $100, and I soon realized that they weren't overly complex. I mean, they're a big giant box that basically holds a 19-inch monitor, a power supply, and, you know, an arcade board, the PCB, which is equivalent of like an arcade, you know, like a cartridge, you know, a Nintendo cartridge. So one of those three are usually what fails. And, you know, I myself, I don't know how to fix all of them. I'm learning how to solder, which is something I never thought I'd, you know, learn how to do. You know, I've replaced capacitors on, you know, power supplies. I'm starting to get into repairing monitors. I still have no clue what I'm doing, but, there's a ton of guys, you know, local to me that do know what they're doing and, you know, are very gracious in this hobby and willing to, you know, I've driven my machine out to, you know, a couple of guys and they've repaired them for free on the spot, which is just, you know, unheard of. I mean, they even helped me carry my machine up to their garage. You know, it's like a 200-300 pound machine. And not only will they, you know, try and fix it, but, you know, they've guided me along while they're trying to repair it as to what they're doing and why they're doing this and how to kind of troubleshoot, which I think is like the most fascinating part of the hobby for me. I mean, honestly, I don't even come down and play the machines very often. I'll come downstairs and wander and just kind of, you know, admire my collection or, you know, kind of wonder what the hell I'm doing. But I've actually, you know, made a decent, not profit on the machines, but I've almost broken even on my collection. I picked up a couple machines for dirt cheap that were worth a whole lot of money, and able to flip them and, you know, make little repairs here and there and flip those machines, you know, buy it for $100 and sell it for $300-$400. I had one machine that I won't even say how much I picked it up for, but it was a tiny amount of money, and I sold it for, you know, like $3,000, and it was amazing. And same goes with pinball machines. I picked up a pinball machine for $20 and sold it for $750 on eBay. So it's just a matter of finding the right collectors, and you know, I try and stick to strictly like the 80s classic machines. I'm not into MAME at all, and I'm not even into the later, like some of the 90s stuff. I'm not really into JAMA. I try and keep everything like as original as possible, because you know that they're historical pieces. You know, as stupid as that might sound to some and corny, the 80s were a huge era for arcade machines, and they were a big deal. I mean, arcade machines were everywhere, and you know, I know when I was growing up, like going into 7-Eleven or my local arcade was called Golden Dome, you know, they'd have a new machine in there every 3-4 weeks, and there was just a crowd of people around it. And honestly, I was only like, you know, between the ages of 4 and 8 years old when, you know, I was kind of, I wasn't even that into it. It was just cool though, you know, everyone thought it was cool. So it's just, they're so old, and there's so much detail on the artwork and just the how they were built. Every machine is, you know, honestly unique. And it just kind of fascinates me, you know, that 30 years ago, something was just so precise and detailed and really revolutionary. It you know, it paved the way for gaming consoles, and there will probably just be never anything like it again. And you know, I guess that's something I appreciate about this hobby, is the historical aspect. It's very unique. And when it comes to, you know, trying to maintain them, you know, I have a friend that helps me do the capacitors, change the capacitors on their monitors. I have a guy in, you know, in the Midwest that will, you know, repair my boards for me for, you know, not too much money at all, and, you know, $50, $60 shipped, you know, to replace a board that's 30 years old, or fix a board, you know, and that's just cool, you know, that you can just find these obscure people that still, like, work on these, like, boards that are, you know, 1.5 foot long. So, I don't know, it's just kind of the fascination of trying to get them going, see if I can get them, you know, working. And knock on wood, you know, my entire collection is working right now. It's almost stressful to have the machines, you know, because, like, I'll turn them all off knowing that they're working, and I almost want to leave it that way, because it's like, okay, well, I know everything's working, so there's no stress. But you know, if I have a party or something, you know, the whole like 6 hours everyone's here, you know, I'm kind of like just eyeing all the machines the whole time, making sure everything looks all right, because they're 30 years old and they can, you know, die at any minute and, you know, need a repair, and it's a pain in the ass to have to lug that 300-pound machine out, you know, after you spent, you know, a month trying to figure out what the problem was and preparing it, and finally getting it put into your row, and you know, you're just like, oh, this is amazing, you know, like, Ataris go next to all the Ataris, and you know, the Midways go with all the Midways, you know, just admiring your row, and then, you know, something goes haywire on it, and you gotta pull it back out, and it's extremely aggravating, and you know, for me personally, he'll just make me grouchy until I have it fixed, and that's something I'm just trying to break. It's just like almost obsessive compulsive, you know. You got to realize these machines are 30 years old. But other than that, it's a great hobby, and I love it. I don't know when I'll quit. You know, I keep telling my wife that it's arcade equity, because I buy cheap, and you know, one day I'll sell high. You know, I've already proven to her that I can, you know, make some good sales. And I always tell her that I'll sell them when my two boys go to college. They'll pay for their college. So we'll see. That's pretty doubtful. But that would be nice. Either way, I'll make some of a profit, because I bought them all cheap. Anyways, I'll show you around the room and let you have a peek at everything. So we'll start here. This is my Asteroids that I picked up probably 3 weeks ago. It's pretty much ready to go. It doesn't have a board in it right now. It's actually being coming back to me on Monday. So that's why I say all my games are working, because this actually will be working after the board is done. I've already, you know, verified everything else. So, got it. It's in pretty nice shape. Space Invaders. I just started having to put games along this back wall. I had focused it on two walls and was trying to keep it like that, but I've run out of room, and that's kind of the way it goes with a whole lot of collectors, and I never thought I was going to be one of them that would say that, but I still have plenty of room, but I really just didn't want to take over my basement, so, but anyways, this is my Space Invaders. I have Bad Cats Pinball, very fun pin. Another thing I've done with some of my games, well, at least the pinballs, is add LEDs to it. That just kind of saves on the power supplies. Just kind of, you know, hopefully one less headache, you know, potentially, since it's using less power and, you know, putting less strain on the machine. Royal Rumble Pinball. My brother and I grew up loving 80s wrestling, and although I don't really watch it now, you know, it's still a lot of fun. We have Robotron, Joust, and now you can see kind of how big the collection is. Frogger, Centipede, Tapper. I actually drove to New Jersey to pick that up. That's how crazy this hobby gets. I live in Maryland, by the way, so it was about a 4-hour drive, but you know, it was worth it. The machine's in nice shape, and one that, you know, like everyone says, you just had to have for your collection. This is Galaga, another absolute classic, and this is the machine right here that started my whole hobby, Miss Pac-Man. And I restored the entire thing. The front is completely hand-painted. I re-hand-painted the entire thing. It's kind of dark, but you know, you kind of get the idea. And you know, this is Burger Time. Outrun, which is probably my newest of my machines when it comes to year. This came out in 89. This kind of even borders on classic to me, but it is classic, obviously. And I had a lot of fun putting quarters in this machine growing up. And same goes with Pole Position, which magically is working. I've never had a problem with mine, knock on wood, so a lot of people have problems with that one. Gyrus is a great game. Kind of similar to Galaga, but first game with stereo sound, and it's a killer. So, and of course, Punch-Out. You know, another thing with this hobby is, you know, you always have to have your supply of parts. I try and have a backup board. I don't have one for all of my games, but I have one for some. So it's just a matter of simply swapping. These are all parts. One bin's pinball, one's arcade, you know, cleaners, spare power supplies, you know, miscellaneous, just junk. You know, that's another thing with this hobby is you just start collecting. There's boards and boards down here, different parts, and just all sorts of stuff. And fortunately, I'm a pretty organized person, and I like things to be neat and tidy, so I don't have a huge issue. And like I said, this is the other part of collecting, is repairs. So one of the assets to arcade collecting is a gentleman by the name of Bob Roberts, who still does things the old-fashioned way. You have to send him a check to get your order. It's all done through email. He doesn't take PayPal. His website was created in, like, you know, 98. And he will cross-ship your order, which means that he will send you your parts before he even receives your payment. But it's on a good faith effort that, you know, you're sending your payment. So that way you get your order faster and you're good to go. So you can get to your repair. So this is what I was talking about. This is an Atari power supply. These are the capacitors for it. You know, desoldering, soldering gun. You know, I do pretty much basic stuff. There's guys that have just insane, you know, test rigs and all sorts of stuff. And I don't think I'll ever get into it that much. But I've also said I wouldn't have any more than like three machines. And now, as you can see, there's quite a collection. So. Anyways, thanks for checking this out, and that's my story.